I work at the University of Oslo, Department of Musicology, but I also work in this group called the 4 M's. The 4 M's are music, mind, motion, machines, and there is a hidden meaning. When you take that acronym, it's forms, it's shapes, so it's a bit to do with Gestalt theory as well. So now you are initiated. Anyway, gesture is a very tricky term, I should say. If we look in the dictionary, it says gesture is a movement or part of the body, especially a hand or the head, to express an idea or a meaning. Now that can sound nice, but if we go closer into music, we see very many occurrences of the term gesture, and it is a bit tricky. So let's start with just having one example. Fingers, hands, arms, and so on, to play Webern's music. But he also makes a whole lot of other motions. So imagine that if you were a producer for this record and you asked, Mr. Gould, very nice, but could you please refrain from doing all those unnecessary motions? the result, I guess, would be quite nasty. So the question is, why does he make all these motions in addition to the music? And we can tentatively speculate on that, but before we do so, I think I should show you a little bit more of what has been said and done. And I would like to a bit immodestly point to a book that I have been participating in making together with my Belgian colleague, Mark Liman. It's called Musical Gestures. And in this, we have an anthology of very much research from the past decades or so. So what we did after many years of discussions, this went on for 4 or 5 years, was to end up with saying, okay, we have two broad classes of music-related gestures. We have so-called sound-producing gestures, meaning that you transfer energy from your body to the instrument or to the human voice. And we have sound accompanying gestures where you move to the sound of music. So as in dance, walking on the street, or just nodding. So to give you some concrete examples, here first one so-called sound accompanying gesture or body movement. You see one dancer, and it's her spontaneous motions to an excerpt from a Ligeti wind quintet. You see 8 copies of her, which are just due to the video processing to enhance different parts of her motion. Thanks to various technologies, we now have the possibility of very closely studying body motion. And this we have now done for a number of years, applied to both sound accompanying motion, but mostly to sound producing motion. So just to give you some examples of what we are doing, I'll show you a short example of pianist performance, where the vantage point, the viewpoint, is from within the keyboard. And then a second one is of a marimba player. Okay, so I can turn this around and I can do a whole lot of mathematical derivations from this. For instance, look at the acceleration and the jerk, which are quite important to our perception of the movement. Okay. So in this case, it was a marimba player where you could see the whole figure. What we have done is to think hard about this, and we have landed on something that we call the motor theory of perception, which is not our invention. It was actually suggested in linguistics in the 1960s, and it has now been extended to other domains. What it said was that when you understand language, when you acquire language, you acquire not just the sounds, but also the so-called phonological gestures that go into making the sound. In other words, perception and thinking in general, they said, was a process of constant mental simulation. Now, that theory received a lot of resistance in the years in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, but after the millennium, neurocognitive research, again, we are back to, Zeki has left, but to the color spots on the brain, they seem to show that motor areas are indeed very often co-activated in different perceptual tasks. So when we speak about listening to music, our idea is that you listen to continuous sound, and then what goes on is that you more or less trace this sound-producing motion that you believe is at the source of what you are hearing, and out of this comes action units, and what we call multimodal action images. So this is the gist of our whole theoretical foundation in our research. It's important to see that this is also in other domains. There is this French neurophysiologist, Alain Berthaus, who has meant quite a lot for me personally. He talks about touching by sight when you look at some visual patterns. Palper par le regard, and I think it's a quote from Cézanne we had earlier today. But when you look at this wrought iron, you see all the ornaments and you have a sense of touch, of course, to a greater or lesser degree. So what we think then is that, okay, we extend this to the whole field of what we call imitation. Imitation is very important, as we know, in oral traditions of music where you don't have notation. But we believe it's still going on even in cultures that do have notation, you know, performance practice and so on, which is definitely imitation. But now I'm talking a bit more specifically how this motor faculty of imagining the source also extends to reproducing the score, the cause, which is well known in onomatopoeticon and scatsing, and most of all in beatboxing, which we are trying to study.
My main elements would be bass kick scratch, where it's or you know, you could do different types of ways of, you know what I mean, flip it like that. And then like you were saying with the words, with the, and then you know, you put it together.
Remarkable is these sounds are not vocal sounds, they are instrumental, mechanical sounds, but still the imitative apparatus is able to tackle that. We have looked at air guitar, air instrument performance, and it tended to provoke quite a lot of controversy. People thought we were crazy, wasting time. The point was, air instrument performance, air guitar, does reveal that people who have no musical training actually know a whole lot about music. We had people in our lab who insisted they were tone deaf, and lo and behold, they could very clearly follow pitch contours. So, just to give you a brief example. Okay, enough. If you're interested, you can go to Oulu in Finland each summer where they have the World Championships in Evita. We did a whole lot of other things. We asked people just simply move spontaneously. You come into the lab, and of course we have privacy considerations, so I can't show you videos of this, but it's very interesting. Most people relate immediately to music, and we have the well-known term of entrainment, meaning that if you have a steady pulse, people tend to start to move, and it has been well documented that this is spontaneous already at the age of 6 months. So there's a whole lot of material by others, and we were specifically interested in the shape. Here you see very early experiment that we did more than 10 years ago. We had digital tablets and we asked people to spontaneously draw the shape of sounds that they heard. And in this case, you have 9 respondents and it has been edited together, so you have a synoptic view of the 9 respondents and you can hear the sounds as we go along. Quite a lot of this a bit more controlled, again coming from musicology into the more hardcore world of experimental psychology. We received a lot of flack, as Americans say, that we are not rigorous enough in our methods, so we have improved, but there is always a trade-off between so-called ecological validity. You try to make the music as real as possible, and yet you try to get clear data. So, what we ended up with is to focus on what we call sound motion chunks. And the name of Pierre Schaeffer has already been mentioned. That was actually, personally for me, my background going back more than 3-4 decades, which always fascinated me. And we ended up with looking at musical time as a roughly 3-level phenomenon. We speak about, to begin with, the most important, this mid-level, which we call the chunk time scale, which is in the duration region of 0.5 to 5 seconds, which also is the world of Pierre Schaeffer sonic objects. Then we have continuous sound, which goes, of course, much faster. And we have the what we call the supra-chunk level, the more large-scale macro level, where you also have narratives and drama. So, the background for Pierre Schaeffer was actually very pragmatic. They were working with Musique Concrète in the days right after the Second World War, before the tape recorder. And the only way they could mix sounds, they thought, was to have a closed loop, CO fermé, which we would call a loop today. And I'll just play you one example. Which was not from Schaeffer, but from a PhD project on DJ scratching. They have something called skip proof in the DJ world, which is essentially exactly the same. Okay, what Schaeffer and colleagues discovered was that when you had these repeated listenings, you had two possibilities. One, go crazy, and the second one, to really dwell into the sound. And they opted for the second one. And they said that this is the source of research, that we start with giving subjective feature descriptions and then we dwell further and further into the sound. So remember that this was in the 1950s, before psychoacoustics as we know it today was developed as a science. So Schaeffer said we must establish correlations between the subjective impressions of sound on the one hand and the acoustical signal on the other one. So what they did was to start to classify sounds on the basis of this very simple, but I believe very useful categories. So they said, we have 3 basic categories. We have impulsive, which is just a peak and a decay. And we have sustained, which is a more protracted energy transfer. And we have iterative, which is a rapid back and forth, and they sound like this. Now, the interesting thing here is that this has very clear correlates also in body motion. Biomechanically, there are 3 different categories because the impulsive is what's called ballistic motion that you typically have in golf, you have it in baseball, tennis, where you have an exertion peak and you relax afterwards. Whereas the sustained is a continuous effort. And the iterative, it's been very clearly demonstrated, for instance, that when you make a tremolo like this, you use a very different set of muscles from when you have individual impulses. So this was very nice. We thought what was it, 12 years ago when we started doing this more systematically, that we can actually now see the convergence of very fundamental sound categories with very fundamental body motion categories. So Schaeffer and colleagues continued this work in the 1950s and 60s. And to give you a historical example, this is from Pierre Schaeffer's Solfège de l'objet sonore, which was issued originally in 1967. And he has a collection of sounds that goes like this.
Guy! Attends-moi! Tiens! Mais... Oh! Il est déjà parti?
In the mid-60s. What they did then was to try to cut this shorter. And the categories that I mentioned, sustained or impulsive, coupled also with pitch, stable pitch versus variable pitch. And I'll play you now the master reading, Schaeffer, of course, telling in French, and I'll point here for those of you who don't understand the French. The point is to chop up into gestalts or very simple, clear shapes, which are related to body motion, to gesture.
Ainsi, combinant entretien soutenu et intonation fixe, nous pourrons rapprocher.
Guy!
Puis, toujours avec entretien soutenu, des intonations variables.
Oh!
Puis, sans entretien, des impulsions fixes en intonation.
Mais...
Et enfin, des impulsions variables en intonation.
Tiens!
Okay, Schaeffer and colleagues then went on to look closer into the sound, qualifying the internal structure of the sound in what's called the morphology. And they developed this very complex scheme, which is really a top-down, subjective questionnaire. You ask what is happening, and on a completely subjective basis, you try to differentiate what goes on. So it looks a bit complicated, but there is a very clear way of reasoning here. Now, just to give you some examples of how these micro gestures are shaped, he had these two main categories called grain and allure in French, grain and gait, and they sound like this. The grain first. Okay, so it's the brr type sound of, in this case, a deep double bass tone. And then a bit slower motion in the sound, we could say is gait or allure. So the idea was that you try to extract patterns from the sound which are somehow related to motion, and to say that these are general categories which can go across different sources, like in this example. You had a drum roll, you had a deep double bassoon tone, and electronic generated sound. So the challenge was to try to make a universal music theory out of the Musique Concrète and also the confrontation with non-Western cultures. Schaeffer was very clear on this. In the years after the GRM, the GRM still exists in Paris, it's the Groupe de Recherche Musicale. There have also been some other similar projects, something called the Sonic Object Project and something called the Unité Sémiotique Temporelle, which I had the pleasure of being a bit involved in some 20 years ago. What they try to do is, inspired by Schaeffer, to make these gestural categories, and they, you can see here in French, they are a bit more, how to say it, semiotically extended. For instance, they have fall, inexorable trajectory, contracted, extended, and so on. So, just to give you one example from a composition by Guy Rebel called Variation en étoile. Since Husserl and William James and William Stern, a contemporary of Husserl actually, and Daniel Stern, the present Stern, they have all been concerned with the present moment. I keep coming back to Husserl 1893 when his first essays on time perception appear. As you know, this classical depiction of what goes on is that Husserl say, by necessity, we proceed by so-called now points, Jetztpunkte in German, which are the accumulation of the recent past, but very importantly, also concern projection towards the future. So it is this anticipatory element, which was really quite extraordinary, I think, in 1893, and fits, as far as I have been able to learn, very well with modern motor theory. So, the idea is that in whatever situation you are, you may have a sense of presence, but you are very much colored by what you just experienced, and you are also preparing for what to do next. In movement science and in linguistics, this has been called co-articulation. The co-articulation means that you have a fusion of micro-level body motion and sounds into larger and holistically experienced chunks of actions and sounds, entailing a contextual smearing of the micro-level elements. And this is well known in speech. If you stand in front of a mirror and you say the word tulip, for instance, so two, and you can feel that the effectors are preparing for the next one, at the same time as you are where you are because of what you have just said. So this is something that we have tried to now, in the past 6-7 years, investigate more closely in music. It means that when you are playing on an instrument, you always have to be ahead of the tone you are playing now. So let's have an example. Seem obvious why the pianist has to do these circular motions, because unless he or she had a tremendously big hand, if he or she had a tremendously big hand, it didn't need to make that motion properly. But still, it's done, and it has to do with the ergonomics of playing, but it has also, of course, to do with the shaping of the sound. Here you see some what we call motion gram developed by one of my co-workers, Alexander Yersenius, which takes the video, actually the video input, and shows very clearly this kind of circular motion. We have had pianists into our lab and reproduced the same movement from this Tempest Sonata by Beethoven. And looking at the wrist and shoulders and elbows, we see very much the same kind of undulating motion. So this is quite important for us to document it. It's maybe partially an obvious point, but if you really want to go into the roots of Gestalt, you have to look at what the body actually does. So we think this is fairly well documented that we do have co-articulation going on in music as well as in language. And I should say in language, the research, amount of research in co-articulation is just huge. It's tremendously big. In music, not so much. So the next stage is to understand motion and gesture in music as centered on certain key postures, meaning that it's not just a continuous, undifferentiated stream of sound and motion, but that we have certain postures at certain important places in the music, typically at downbeats and other accents. So schematically, this means that if I'm going to hit a drum, I start at an equilibrium, I extend my hand and bang, hit, and then I go back. So this is a kind of archetype motion, common to many instruments. If you have those more closely, you see an overlap between the prefix and suffix of these different chunks, resulting in what appears to be continuous motion. And this is actually exactly the same as they say in linguistics when it comes to the vocal tract. So, in other words, when we return to Gould, we could pick out certain key postures that are particularly salient. It's something well known from caricatures. It does have its advantages because it can accommodate continuity and discontinuity at the same time. So let's return to this marimba example. Okay, you can see here it's a blub blub up like that, up to the high B flat. And here you see the position that the percussionist aims for this B flat, and arms continue up in the air. Here you can see the velocity, that you have a tremendous negative velocity and a positive velocity, meaning the speed is very great at that moment, and that is also reflected in the acceleration. This is quite challenging because motions made in musical performance typically are quite small. Now this was a whole torso and mallet motion, but if we look at piano, okay, Beethoven first piano concerto, you see here that you have the upbeat, the hand typically goes up and then down, of course, at the downbeat. Interestingly, if you look at the velocity, you have a negative velocity, meaning that it goes down, and you also have that reflected in the acceleration. So, in other words, we are trying to physicalize the notion of a beat and downbeat, saying that a downbeat is reflected in maximum acceleration and velocity. So what we are trying now is to gather as much as possible detailed information in different kinds of instrumental music, for instance. Micro movements of ornaments on string instruments. So it's late in the day, so in summary, I think it's fair to claim that listening to music as sound tends to evoke images of sound producing gestures, of course, variably so. Secondly, that music is, in fact, from that point of view, clearly a multimodal art, combining sound and motion, hence also including visual images as well as sensations of effort.